I'm Tom Prince with Western New York Athletics, and you are here at our next edition of the Western New York Athletics Coach's Corner. I couldn't be more excited with our guest today. As you know, we have talked a lot about these multiple programs on different programs of the Western New York Athletics Coach's Corner. Joined with me today, with Iroquois, Brian Davis with Amherst, and Mark Waple with Lewiston Porter. And before I get into any questions, I want to give some special recognition to Karen Edwards of Lewport, who actually will be designing my new border that you guys will see when we go ahead and launch this out from here on in. And I really want to put a special acknowledgement to him. His logo is up in the right-hand corner. I wanted to give him some special kudos as he was instrumental in getting this up and running. So I want to say thank you so much to Karen. But guys, before we start off, I got to say, how are you making out? How are you doing? What's going on personally? Chris, let's start with yourself.
Well, we're doing about all we can. You know, you try to maintain some contact with your players and just try to keep sane. You know, we're watching, I'm watching probably more baseball on television right now than I have in a long time. And you try to pick up different trends that you might have seen in years past to what's going on today. But for the kids, there's not much they can do. They can, you know, everything's got to be on their own, and that's going to be allowing the kids to kind of separate themselves. Who's going to be ready to play when we do get the green light, if we get the green light?
Yeah, no doubt about it. It was funny, just beforehand, I was out watching the clip of George Brett and the Pine Tar home run in the Kansas City game against the Yankees. So I love watching some of those. I watched that game live too, which was awesome. But exactly what you mean there, Coach. Brian, how about yourself?
Yeah, same. Just doing the best I can to try to keep in contact with my players, trying to keep them engaged. It was quite the tease to only have them together for, I think I had two practices after tryouts. And, you know, was feeling good about getting going with this group of guys. So I set up a Google Classroom where I'm pushing out, you know, workouts for them and ideas, things they could do at home. And also, you know, some contact with them via Twitter. But, you know, like Chris said, just trying to find out who's going to stay with it and on top of things so that if we do get ready to go here, that they'll be ready to go out and compete.
And Mark, how about yourself?
Looking at it from an opportunity, you know, that's what we preach to the kids. It can be positive if you look at it that way. The opportunity to take the time to get better, whether it's by watching videos or going through the Google Classroom documents that we send or text, but just staying active, staying physically fit. Those are the only things that we can ask the kids to do. We really can't recommend that they get together and have captain's practices or do things on their own. But if you take advantage of the time that you have and ask yourself the question, what are you willing to do that no one else is going to do to make you better, then something positive will come out of it.
Oh, I like that one. Great great answer right there, Coach. So, perfect. Let's get into now my questions that I have for you guys. My first question is, coaches have different philosophies on handling a pitching staff, especially with their catchers. Some coaches like to call their own games as far as the pitch counts or what the pitch is. Some like to teach the catcher on how to call a game. What is your philosophy and why? Brian, let's start out with yourself.
Well, we've done a little bit of both over the last, this is going to be my 14th year coaching. We were very fortunate in a two catcher stretch where we had Jonah Heim for 3 years. And then right after him, we had Brian Fulford for four. So those were the two instances where towards the tail end of their careers, we let them start to call the games. But for the most part, we call the games as coaches. I know probably with Jonah, his last 2 years, we let him take over because he had a really good command of the staff and counts. And same thing with Fulford. When Brian Fulford was a senior, he had a pretty good idea of what we were trying to do, and it seemed quite a bit. So that's what we try to do. If we have, you know, if we can get a younger catcher in there and kind of groom them, we like to let them take that over. But if we've got a young catcher who doesn't have much experience, we'll typically call the games.
Okay. Mark, how about yourself?
Again, opportunity for the catcher to learn the game from behind a dish. I just want to comment, you know, catching is a lost art. There's not a lot of kids that want to do that. You know, when you find a good one or a kid that really takes the position and owns it. You got a special kind of kid. I know Chris does a good job training some kids out of his place, and that helps all of us. We happen to have a kid this year. We've had him for, this will be his third year, and he's only 11th grade. So over that time period, we've brought other kids in to be backups, and we encourage them to learn the game. All calls go through the catcher. All signs go through the catcher. He's literally the quarterback of the defense. So, you know, when they start to understand why things are done, the intent and purpose of signs and calls and positioning, they kind of own the game. They like it. They understand it more. It's more meaningful to them. So we want to teach them to do that, so eventually they can call their own game. But right now, we're calling all the pitches.
Chris, you know this question was designed with you right here, right? So what do you think?
Yeah, I figured. Well, I actually had the luxury of, before I took the position, became a high school coach, to the catcher I'm walking into right now is a kid that I've trained. So, you know, over the last few years, we go over with all the catchers different situations, how to set up hitters, what to look for, understanding how to get a feel for your pitcher. Knowing what is working, what is not working, and then how you want to go ahead and attack a hitter. So if we have, you know, if we got a very aggressive team, then we're gonna have meetings before the game leading up to it, and we want to put them in a position where they're thinking a couple pitches ahead. You know, I want my catcher to be able to come back into the game and use it as a teaching experience. So if he gave up a couple hits, I want to know, number one, what signs was he putting it down? Why was he putting it down? And was it a matter of going with his gut or going and having the pitcher shake it off? Because at the end of the day, the pitcher is the one who's got to throw it, so he's got to be comfortable doing it. But for the catchers right now, you know, for high school, you can see guys that are dead pull hitters or guys that have slower bats or maybe not the best looking swings. And you take a couple of those hitters in each lineup, and those are the guys you really have to talk about. You don't want the big hitters from another team to be the ones that are going to beat you, or when the game is on the line, have them in a position to beat you. And it's just preparation. I mean, this is all off-season stuff that we've done with, you know, with all the catchers, you know, how to set up for counts, you know, which counts do you want to go, what types of pitches, what locations, what allows you to get further off the plate, you know, when you can go off the plate, when you should go inside, different things. So by the time that they get to the game, they're prepared to execute it. And if they don't, you know, then I'll obviously pull them aside and kind of let them know what I would think to do. And they'll always have the option to look at me if they just aren't sure, you know, to look at me, almost kind of give me a sign and saying, hey, I need a little help here. What do you suggest? And then at that point, then I'll flip them what I would call.
Awesome. Great answers, guys. So my next question for you guys, a lot of coaches have said on this program, I have a player that can hit and I will find a place for them somewhere on the field. May not know yet, but I'll find a place to put them. Do you believe in that philosophy, or do you believe that the philosophy that my defensive player, that's the player that I'm going to find a place for them on the field because I can put them anywhere and that defense may trump what person can do hitting? So what is your philosophy and why? Mark, let's start with yourself.
Well, it's interesting because you really can't view it like a football team would, where you can be a one-way player. It's like basketball or soccer. If you're on the field, you have to play offense and defense. So, you know, if you're better at one than the other, it makes you a one-dimensional player. So as a coach, and I'm sure the other guys would agree, you always want to stress you got to be the best you can in both sides. Can't win games without scoring runs, and you can't score runs without putting the ball in play. So contact and putting the ball in play is important. So I guess I would say that I do subscribe to that. However, I would never put a hitter in the game that is a defensive liability, because there's more to playing defense than just catching and throwing. There's positioning and defensive plays, pickoff moves, rundowns, things like that. So, you know, we'll put the best kid at each position. What we do stress is that every player on our team should learn multiple positions, so that, you know, if you're that good as a defensive player and you're, all things being equal, the hitter will get the start.
Okay. Chris, how would you answer that one?
Well, for, see, I've watched the Yankees kind of not get to the World Series the last few years. And, you know, a lot of it comes down to defense. You've got guys that hit, you know, tons of home runs. And at the end of the day, when you get into crunch time, when you get into playoffs, what's going to win? It's not so much the long ball, but it's two strike hitting. It's going to be putting the ball in play. So, but defense, you can't afford to make errors, you know, whether it's a catcher, whether it's middle infielder. I want speed in the outfield. I don't care if you've played shortstop your whole life. If you run like a deer, you're going to do more good for me out in the outfield. You know, so I want my defense set up first. And then you're going to have kids that are two way guys, as far as, you know, you're better hitters, compared to kids that maybe they can just hit and that's it. And if that's the case, then those kids would maybe be a DH, but I don't want to have any position out in the field where, you know, a fly ball, I have to, you know, close my eyes, or a routine ground ball, worry if he's going to kick it or not. I want the fielders to come first and then find a way to get it done at the plate.
And Brian, how about yourself?
Yeah, I agree with what the guy said. I mean, I tend to lean, and maybe this is just specific to my teams over the last number of years, but I tend to lean more towards the hitters. I have a similar philosophy to what Mark said, in that I try to get kids to play multiple positions. And we've been pretty fortunate with that. Obviously in high school baseball, you've got kids who pitch and then need to play somewhere else. So, you know, I like to work with the kids to get them to be able to play multiple positions, so they have that opportunity to move them around. I feel like what's killed us the last couple of years is hitting. You know, we've played good defense and we've pitched well, and we're losing games 5-2, 4-3. Just like Mark said, not putting the ball in play. So I think, you know, again, it's, you're not going to find, it'd be great if you could find 9 players who could, you know, play the field and all hit really well. But in my opinion, if I've got to lean one way or the other, I'm going to lean towards the bat, and try to find a spot where I'm comfortable with them in the field than somebody who's a great fielder, but who's never putting the ball in play. You know, when we only get, you know, a certain amount of outs a game, you know, you can't afford to have a spot in the lineup coming up every time that's going to be an out for you.
You know, something else we could add is that, you know, that's where we earn our bones. If you can't hit, coach him up. If you can't field or throw, coach him up. That's our job.
No doubt about it. Great answers there, guys. Now, like I always say, the fun part of our program. Now you get a chance to talk about each one of your teams, makeup of the players, and what could happen if they go ahead and take the field. We've got some great teams that we're going to go here and talk about. I'm going to first start off out. Chris, let's talk about this Iroquois team. You've got a big team coming back that's got a chance to do something great this year. You are led by a Division I candidate. Your pitcher out on the mound will be going to a Division I school. You've got a young crop of players, pitchers that are coming up that are going to be unbelievably strong here in Western New York. You're mixing some veterans with some youth. Let's talk about the makeup of Iroquois.
So we've got a really nice mix of athletes. We have 3 sophomores that we kept on varsity that will contribute. We have probably about 11, maybe 12 kids that can pitch. So we have already discussed, you know, what our goals for would be on the mound. We used not a whole lot of time to do the teaching. But we're trying to do a little bit of development with these kids too. But for our team overall, I mean, there's just, I don't think we're going to ever run out of arms. We've got we got kids that are, you know, I got a couple kids that are mid upper 80s right now. You know, you get a Division I player that will be, you know, our big game guy, or we might use him as a closer. You know, Nick's arm angles are so funky. He goes all the way around the dial and throw strikes, keeps the ball down. As far as our other attributes, we've got a good size. The first time I walked out for tryouts, we had our you know, freshmen through seniors up there, and I looked, and everyone was like eye level with me. So, you know, there's just a bunch of really big kids out there, and you know, we've tested them as far as how they swing the bats. We've done some things with their arms, and it's just exciting, especially with this weather, you know, that you play in when you're dealing with anywhere from 35 to 55. Hopefully you get a 60 day or above, but it is stressful on the arms, and it's a nice luxury knowing that, you know, I don't have to run out, you know, one or two guys every other day. I can go to, you know, I can pitch three or four per game if I need to, just to keep the innings down, keep the arms fresh for when the season, you know, nears the end and you're trying to make a push. But no, I'm excited with what I've walked into, especially at the lower levels. The younger kids are going to be kids that have a real chance to go on to play at the next level. You know, I believe that with every single one of the kids. You know, we want them to kind of break the mold, not to just say, hey, I had a good high school career. Like, we're not going to be happy unless they are able to say, hey, coach, I made my college team, or I'm going off to this place, you know, or can you call this school on me? You know, that's the fun part about what I'm doing right now.
Chris, can you give us some makeup? Can you tell us about some of the players to look out for?
Okay, so let's see. Tyler Bird is probably going to be our shortstop this year. You know, he's a mid-80 guy across the diamond, one of the top hitters last year on the team. Even though he's going to school for golf, he's an exceptional golfer. I got Nick Parch on the mound. I've got Evan Yandrika on, you know, as my catcher behind the plate. You know, Evan is probably one of the better ones in Western New York, and he'll compete for, you know, for a number of different things behind the plate with most of the other kids out there. As far as pitchers go, you know, a couple sophomores, Owen Silliman and Cam Fear, both of those kids, you know, when we were doing our testing, they were, you know, they're already throwing in the mid 80s right now. And as sophomores with just big athletic bodies, you know, they're going to do nothing but get better as the years progress. And, you know, the junior class is real deep. And like I said, we've got a number of athletes. It's just very exciting to be a part of it.
And Nick is off to Siena, am I correct?
Correct. Yeah, he'll head out there next year. And, you know, he's a guy that, you know, I saw some film on over the summer, and then getting a chance to see him throw a couple bullpens. Just, you know, he'll go all the way around the dial. He'll go a low three-quarter arm. He'll try to get up on top. Last year, I believe he topped out at 87 over the summer. But he's definitely a wrinkle guy. You know, he can keep the ball around the plate, keep it down. You know, and he mixes up his pitch as well. You know, we've talked about a couple little adjustments so he doesn't tip things, more or less for when he moves on to college than, you know, for worrying about high school kids to kind of look at his motion and say, oh, this is how he's tipping it. But no, he's going to be a good one. You know, we just got to get some weight on him like a number of other kids.
Yeah, great kid, great family too. Love what he's got to offer. We're going to talk to him tomorrow as part of From the Sidelines in our interview tomorrow. Can't wait to talk to him. But you've got a great team, and there's no doubt we can't wait to see them take the field because they've got a great chance of going after a sectional title. So now let's go off to Brian in Amherst. Brian, you got a younger team coming up. You've got some big youth right now coming up through that program, especially at the sophomore class right now that I know is coming up into the ranks. You add that with some of the veteran mix that you've got, and you're going to have a tough team that's going to go out to the field. Let's talk about the makeup of Amherst and what they're going to bring to the season.
Yeah, so we were very excited about our team that we had put together this year. Like you said, we have a strong sophomore class. We brought up three sophomores that we feel could contribute right away. One being Brendan Kantz, infielder, and can pitch a little bit too. Matt Kroll, who plays on our hockey team as well, probably one of the better players on our Amherst hockey team. He's sophomore, he can play the infield, he can throw. And then Jack Foster, who's a younger brother of one of our former players, Nick Foster, who is a four-year starter for us. We're excited to have those three young guys up. And they're, you know, our modified program and our JV program are getting stronger. Over the last probably 5 or 6 years, I think it was about 6 years ago, my assistant coach Chris Dolce and I started a camp locally, the FBI baseball camp that we do down at Central Amherst for kids 6 to 13. And we're starting to see, one of the things we wanted to do was to try to get our kids playing together more at a younger age. Because here in Amherst, there's so many different little leagues that the kids separate. And then, you know, they're all in different little leagues. Some are in Matheson McCarthy, some are in Central Amherst, some are in Lou Gehrig. And so they're not really playing together. So that was one of the reasons for our camp, was to, you know, get the kids playing together at a younger age. And we're starting to see that these kids, you know, coming up now are all kids that we worked with when they were 6, 7 years old. Our junior class is pretty strong as well. We have two juniors who've been with us since they were freshmen who will be leaders on the team, Garen Fott and Nick Tabiri. Garen's a pitcher for us, has been a starter since he was up as a freshman playing third base for us. This year he'll probably have to slide over and play shortstop since Ben Nagy, our shortstop and number one pitcher last year, graduated, obviously. So Garen will assume the shortstop role and probably be our number one pitcher. And then Nick Tabiri has been a catcher for us since his freshman year. We've been, you know, grooming him behind the plate. So this will be his, you know, third year behind the plate for us. I'm feeling strong about him as well. And then we have a couple of other juniors that were called up during the year last year. Josh Wolski, you know, played some of the year last year for us as a sophomore. He can play outfield, left-handed bat. Bill Thomas is a returning senior for us. He'll be one of our stronger players, starting outfielder. We've got some other transfers that actually came back, which we're excited about. Unfortunately, we lose kids a lot to the private schools here in Amherst, whether it's, you know, St. Joe's or Canisius. And just recently, we had two players transfer back. Jackson Dobies and Sam Couts transferred back from St. Joe's.
Did we lose you there, Brian?
So we're excited to have them back. No, I'm still here. Can you hear me okay?
Yep, got you now.
Yeah. Yeah, so Jackson Dobies and Sam Couts are both junior transfers coming back from St. Joe's. We're happy to have them back. You know, both strong players that played in our modified program and then left us and have now come back. And Ryan Stark, he's also a hockey player for Amherst. He'll be one of our starting first basemen. And Ben Levine, returning senior, one of our better hitters last year, mostly DH for us. Jacob Sorensen, a junior, coming up for us, threw a lot of innings on our JV last year, good solid pitcher. So similar to what Chris said, we've got a lot of arms. We're excited about our arms. Again, we've just, and man, we try different stuff every year, but just trying to find a way to get the bats going. You know, I'm looking back through our scores from last year, and there weren't too many games where we scored more than 5 runs in a game. And you're not going to win too many games if you're not scoring more than 5 runs in high school. So if we can find ways to get the bats going, you know, I really like our chances. One of the other things that I think, you know, helps us is, you know, having recently moved back up to Division II. You know, we play Will East, Will South, Hamburg, but then we drop down to A2 for sectionals. So I think it's, you know, it's a good thing because we're, you know, playing some schools that are bigger than us during the regular season. And then when we move into sectionals, we're playing schools that are more our size and some schools, honestly, that we haven't really seen during the season, which can sometimes help you when it comes to scouting. You know, because unless you played them in a non-league contest, you know, they're teams that you haven't seen, which I think is helpful too. We all know how hard it is to play a team 3 times in a season. So when you end up playing the teams that are in your regular league, you know, it makes it that much more difficult in sectionals. But, you know, really excited. Again, the younger class that we have some kids that can be some leaders and definitely be a part of our program for the next couple of years.
I've seen those sophomores play all summer long. I know you've got some good sophomores there. Can't wait to see them take the field. I know they're going to make that team even stronger. There's no doubt about it. So now, Mark, let's go over to Lou-Port. No doubt.
Yeah, for sure.
Very tough division right there. When you compete in the Niagara Frontier League division, it is tough from top to bottom. You got anywhere from Niagara Falls to Lockport to Kenmore West to Ken East. We can go up and down, right? Niagara Wheatfield, another one. You know you're going to see a great game day in and day out. I know you've got a great pitching staff that's been put together. You've got a tough team. You know you're going to get stronger this year. I am dying to hear the makeup of Lou-Port and what you're going to bring to the field.
Well, first and foremost, imagine the first practice going back I mean, that's really what we're trying to get to is that first practice, that reuniting day where we can look at each other and actually embrace each other and say, we have another opportunity. We're going to be able to play now. That's going to be a special day. And that's what I'm looking forward to most is reuniting and getting the sense of normalcy back into their lives, you know, emotionally and socially, so that, you know, the seniors can start to carry on with their senior spring season that they've worked so hard for. I have 5 returning seniors and 6 returning juniors that have all played 3 years, 2 or 3 years. Some of these guys have been with me since 9th grade. We've built over the past 3 and 4 years for this particular season. It would be, you know, pretty sad if we couldn't, you know, play some games and compete together. If for anything else, just for closure for them, because they're a special group. They're really nice kids. I have my seniors are Nicky Carlo, 2-year outfielder. He's going to see some mound time. We have Anthony Dragoni. Coincidentally, his first start was in sectionals against the Iroquois down at your place when he was in 8th grade, and he played a good game that game. He's been on varsity ever since. Cooper Krawczak, who will go to Westminster next year and play down there. He's going to start in the outfield and play multiple positions on the infield, and he'll even see some mound time. Lucas Yuke, first base, outfield pitcher. Zach Reed, infield pitcher. And we had a transfer also from St. Joe's. Nick DiCarlo, Lew-Port kid, went to St. Joe's in 9th grade, but transferred back in the fall. He'll play infield for us. And we want to build around that spine, catcher, pitcher, middle infield, center field. So that will be one of Nick's positions. Second base is open, could be Dragoni, could be another kid. Dom Fazzolari is that 3-year starter behind the plate, very, very good leadership skills, very, very heady player, and has learned, like I said, from catching so many years, how we like to do things, positioning, and he's the kind of kid that if you tell him one time, all you got to do is mention it one time, it never leaves. He knows his importance. Some of the other juniors, Spencer Reeler, Adam Coppins, both starting pitchers, 1A and 1B in any particular order. We've got, let's see, I mentioned Dom. We have Peter Spimeni, another 2-year player. So, you know, we've got guys coming back, and all we're asking them to do is their particular job. Do your 1/9, so to speak. You know, you're 1/9 of the lineup, just do your job. And, you know, like I said before, getting back together, these guys are close. They're a close-knit bunch. They love being around each other, like doing things together. And, you know, just to get back together and get out of the diamond is going to be just it's going to be a fun day.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Guys, that's great. I mean, like you said, you've got some great teams. I can't wait to hopefully get a chance to take them on the field. That was the end of my questions right there. I want to say thank you so much for joining me on the Western New York Athletics Coach's Corner. Great to hear about your teams. I hope the next time we get a chance to see each other is at the fields, so we get a chance to actually see these kids actually take the field and do what they've been meant to do right now. So thanks again, guys.
Thanks, Tom.
Good luck, guys.